Yeah, too, and again, the branching of the road, it seems like it's pulled apart as like this separate commitment or answering the call, but, you know, just hearing your experiences as you work with Jessica and about, like, the things with homework and different things where you have pulled back and you are saying in many ways, whether it's verbal or not, you know, you're going to need to take responsibility for your mind. You know, that's being a teacher of God, is being clear oneself and not getting into the old protective modes and this and that. And that's the thing, what it really comes down to when you talk about answering this call is just getting clearer and clearer and asking the Holy Spirit, you know, what is most helpful to communicate this. A lot of times it doesn't, as Mary will attest many times, it doesn't involve the actual words from the Course, and I know with Jessica it wouldn't work either, but it's that sense of really communicating that joy. That's the inclusiveness. That's what people feel, so to speak.
That's what's attractive.
They feel the non-judgment. They feel very included. Whether it involves any metaphysics or any words like that, it's taught in so many little ways and demonstrated. And to me, that's the thing. Instead of starting to pull it out from, okay, now what do I have to do to answer this call? To really say, oh, I have been answering this call. And anything that seems to be come to mind that would be seen as a guilt or a deprivation or sacrifice, I will continue to question that as I have been, and I will continue.
There's something else that I was thinking as you were saying that, and that is that it's not about looking for permission to answer the call either. There's got to be something in there that, you know, the Holy Spirit's saying, come, and you're not going out to the world and saying, should I? Do you think I should do this? That brings Bud's story to me. I went to a friend of ours. They've been very involved with the Course for years, and they love flowers, and they have a lot of perennials and that kind of thing. So they called me one day and said, would you like to come over and get some, I'm dividing my flowers, would you like to get some perennials? And I said, sure. So I went over, and I don't even have enough room for the perennials that Bud was giving me. But he kept digging, and it was just really a holy encounter. I didn't really care about the perennials. We were having, you know, a good conversation, and he was digging and putting in my car and bringing them over. And pretty soon, my whole van was full of perennials. And when I sat and told them about this call and that I was going to follow this, you know, and that I didn't know how it was going to look, and I can't be concerned about the future, but I'm making this commitment that I've never made before. Bud was very happy for me, and he said, but Mary, realize something. He says, the amount of people that will support you are the amount that you can fit in your van with those perennials. And I looked and I thought, oh, great, could I squeeze at least 5 in here? You know, I mean, probably 3, you know. So that kind of in my, with a smile of joy, though. It wasn't, well, you know how many people are going to support you. It was just a smile of joy. It was like, and you know, this is, you need to do this, but, you know, that's what's going to be. So it's not about going out and seeking permission. Because if I were doing that, I obviously, from a world sense, no, I don't know that I'd be getting permission. So, you know, it wasn't about that.
Yeah. Not permission, but I have had a real sense of people understanding on some level.
Oh, yeah. That I did too, Rhonda.
The clearer I get, and the more I'm open to asking for help and communicating that, and you know, people are seeing something,
and they're not really sure
a lot of times what it is, but they're hearing something that they like, and it's not that they're supporting me or not supporting me, but there is a recognition.
Well, I found that same thing, and at this point now, it's like there are, you know, that word has been used, like they're counting on you, but there are people counting on me. My children are counting on me, my husband, you know, all of the people that I come into contact with, my family, not family, immediate family, but family. And about family, I remember Mom saying, are you going to be home with your family? And I said, what family? You know, I will be home with, this is my family. This is my family. you know. And I remember walking today, looking at different homes like you did today, thinking, what is my home? That's another.
Is my home.
Yeah, you know, that's a whole other way, different way of me looking at anything.
You know, it's always like there was a particular place.
The mind is my home, and it goes with me everywhere.
And it sounds like that these people that are supporting you are in your mind anyway.
Yes.
So naturally, the clearer you get, the better these support groups are going to be always.
And I have found that.
Because it's a reflection of my clarity comes back to me.
That's all it is.
It really comes down to, it pulls it away from the form, even a quantitative form, because it comes down to, what do I want to see my brother as? A witness, as a savior, as a witness for God, or as a witness for the ego? So again, that comes down to, which lens am I looking through? And that's the next, that's once above, even from a quantifiable sense of, like, there seems to be more and more people that are really saying, there's something there that, as I'm approaching, well, which way will I see my brother here? Bright-minded, supportive, thank you. Regardless of what the form is, there's a feeling of gratitude because of the purpose that I'm holding on to. And with the ego lens, regardless of what the form is, someone could even... Someone could say, they're supporting you. If you're looking through, if you're with the ego lens, it's not. It's going to be perceived as attack, or it'll be perceived as
booing.
And that has also been a part of my experience very strongly. And like you said, I've expressed it to everybody that I can remember talking to, was just expressing my gratitude, because that was such a, it just was like flowing out that, just thank you for your willingness to even come to me and talk, you know, no matter how you feel about it. You know, my sister, who's still seemingly angry about it, even her, I said, thanks for being willing just to talk.
And keep talking.
And I said, and I don't take it personally. You know, I'm willing
That's
to keep
something
working
there, too.
With you.
I don't take it personally.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
How could we?
And the upset is never with me personally.
No.
You know, if there seems to be an upset, it's because of what I, you know, would represent.
Stepping
Not because of me. Yeah.
This next paragraph goes right into the pen what we just said.
Whenever a teacher of God has tried to be a channel for healing, he has succeeded. Should he be tempted to doubt this, he should not repeat his previous effort. That was only maximal, because the Holy Spirit so accepted it and so used it. Now the teacher of God has only one course to follow. He must use his reason to tell himself that he has given the problem to one who cannot fail, and must recognize that his own uncertainty is not love, but fear, and therefore hate. His position has thus become untenable, for he is offering hate to one to whom he offered love. This is impossible. Having offered love, only love can be received. It is in this that the teacher of God must trust. That is what is really meant by a statement that the one responsibility of the miracle worker is to accept the atonement for himself. The teacher of God is a miracle worker because he gives the gifts he has received. Yet he must first accept them. He need do no more, nor is there more that he could do. By accepting healing, he can give it. If he doubts this, let him remember who gave the gift and who received it. Thus is his doubt corrected. He thought the gifts of God could be withdrawn. That was a mistake, but hardly one to stay with. And so the teacher of God can only recognize it for what it is, and let it be corrected for him.
About even the mind looks back and thinks, well, now in this circumstance, I don't know if the task was completed. I attempted to heal, but if I'm looking back and doubting that the task was completed, then he's just saying, teacher of God, right now, you know, accept another way. And to me, that's really important, because even if you look at it in a linear sense, again, you can get back into saying, well, I seem to have been more successful in sharing my purpose and holding my intent in certain situations. In other situations, I seem to have been less successful. But that whole thing, you know, just kind of, for me, it just dissolves in that, in the idea that, well, it depends on which lens I was looking through, or it depends on which person I was holding, which purpose I was holding. That really is what it comes down to. It doesn't have anything to do with whether they seem to be receptive at the time, they seem to react positively, they seem to react lukewarm, they seem to react negatively. You know, it really didn't have anything to do with what I was perceiving on the screen. It just totally brings it really back to that inward thing of, well, will I hold the torch, the light and the truth out front, or not? You know, it takes it away from even looking back to from this point forward, so to speak. What will I choose to hold? What will I choose to teach with? To me, that's the beautiful thing about the Course. It just, all of the past is gets snipped off. And you don't even have to, you know, you start thinking, wow, I don't even have to go back and break it apart.
Mm-hmm. Just start again right now.
Just blow the feathers away.
My, you're getting your magnitude there. If a memory seems to come, you can think of that.
Yeah.
If it seems to ruffle your feathers,
yeah.
You can think.
Ready for the next one? In order to heal, it thus becomes essential for the teacher of God to let all his own mistakes be corrected. If he senses even the faintest hint of irritation in himself as he responds to anyone, let him instantly realize that he has made an interpretation that is not true. Then let him turn within to his eternal guide, and let him judge what the response should be. So is he healed, and in his healing is his pupil healed with him. The sole responsibility of God's teacher is to accept the atonement for himself. Atonement means correction, or the undoing of errors. When this has been accomplished, the teacher of God becomes a miracle worker by definition. His sins have been forgiven him, and he no longer condemns himself. How can he then condemn anyone? And who is there whom his forgiveness can fail to heal?
Ready for our closing paragraph of the night.
The emphasis of this course always remains the same. It is at this moment that complete salvation is offered you, and it is at this moment that you can accept it. This is still your one responsibility. Atonement might be equated with total escape from the past and total lack of interest in the future. Heaven is here. There is nowhere else. Heaven is now. There is no other time. No teaching that does not lead to